thanks for coming for another Tech Jam session. This time we have a slightly different topic, and it's our pleasure to welcome Mr. Rakesh Pai over here. I'm trying to be as formal as possible. Rakesh is a good friend, and he's the creator of Errorception, which is a JavaScript error tracking tool. Handles a huge amount of error traffic, which is what we thought would be very interesting to talk about, how he's gone about architecting the whole Errorception. He's used Node.js and a bunch of other things. It's not obviously a marketing talk for the tool. It's more about trying to understand the technology, the internals of how it's built. I've also requested him to kind of give a quick dive into what distributed computing is and how he's actually been able to achieve some of the distributed computing on his thing. And we'll also get into the definition of what distributed computing means. So with that, I'll hand it over to Rakesh. Thanks, Rakesh.
Thanks. My name is Rakesh Pai. And I run this service called Errorception. And I'm here today to talk about variables, not about distributed computing. That's too complicated. I'm just going to talk about variables in your programming language, whatever your programming language. It's awesome because there's just so much to learn about variables. And there is a lot to learn because, you see, I started my career as a front-end developer, which meant that I messed around with HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. Mostly JavaScript, though. That was my sort of love of my life, right? But as it turns out, about 3 years ago, if you're going to be working with JavaScript, the only space you can work in was the browser, right? There's no other place to work in if you're working with JavaScript, which meant that I got lumped in usually with like the design team in the company and so on, which is sort of weird because I have the design skills of like an alcoholic monkey or something. I basically fling stuff at a wall, and if it sticks, it works. You know, that's my design skills basically. So it's horrible to lump me in with a design skill with the design team. But whatever. That said, so I used to hang out mostly with, you know, the dev teams or whatever, trying to focus on my craft of JavaScript, so to say. And I was always jealous of the tools that the backend developers had, because you see, if you think about it, it's quite awesome about, you know, it's quite awesome to think about the fact that you control your servers, you control your runtime environment, you control what you install on it, you control how it runs. It's just beautiful. Whereas we client-side developers are used to running code in the browser at somebody else's end on who knows what machine, who knows not what things installed and operating system. It's just too complicated, right? And considering that it's such a hostile environment to program in, was very good reason for tooling to be better over there, but there was a distinct lack of tooling. And so when I decided that I want to start up with Errorception about 3 years ago, it was to fix one of the problems with the tooling chain, with the tool chain, which is that if there are errors that occur in the browser, there is no way for the developer to find out about such errors because those errors are happening remotely, right, at somebody else's end. They're logged to that console, which is the most useless place to write an error to. And the developer never gets notified. So I wanted to sort of fix this. And the reason I'm talking about this is not a pitch again. The reason I'm talking about this is so that you get a sense of what Errorception does. What I essentially do is I give people a little script snippet that they have to insert into their page. And this sort of attaches a global event, a global error listener, takes the errors from there, posts that to Errorception servers. And then from Errorception servers, it takes over. And it processes that, deduplicates. So there's just tons of stuff to be done, and it finally, you know, aggregates it. That's another big deal. And then it writes it to the database so that users, the site developers, can come and have a look at it. These are some of the stats as it stands right now of Errorception. It receives around 6,000 requests per second, and I have seen it reach 12,000 requests per second peak. And I must remind you, this is running on one machine. So I did not know how big of a deal this was until I realized that when Obama became president of the United States, was when Twitter recorded the largest number of tweets per second. And that was 6,000. And so that blew my mind that I'm at the scale at which Twitter is. Now, of course, that's a very, very crazy statement to make because Twitter's write loads are low compared to Twitter's read loads. The reads are far more frequent than writes. So basically, writing is not the most important thing that Twitter does. But all that said and done, this was at somewhat a comparable number. The numbers look similar, and that blew my mind. When I was building it, though, I had no clue that this is actually a big number. When I started, it was a very simple stack. It was essentially just Node.js talking to Mongo. which is, you know, your regular application stack. It's an application that's talking to a database, and that's about it. It's very simple. This worked for about 50 connections per second. And then after that, it started breaking down. It did not scale very well. And well, fortunately for me, because I was a front-end developer, and even though I was a front-end developer, since I hung out with developers who were working on back-end stuff, there were ideas that I had picked up along the way, but I had never really got to exercise because I was working in the browser environment, that I thought I will try to reuse over here. And one such idea is that of variables, so cycles back to variables. I think I saw this first in an SICP lecture. It blew my mind. Yeah, I don't read books. I'm against books. It's 15th century technology. I focus on YouTube videos. That's far better, isn't it? So rather than reading the SICP textbook, I decided I'll watch video lectures of it on YouTube. And it turns out that the authors of the book are the ones who give the lecture, so it's totally worth. SICP, if you don't know, is Structure and Interpretation of Computer Programs. It's like a entry level course. I think it's Stanford, if I'm not mistaken. It's an entry level course in Stanford for computer science. And so it's damn funny that he gets until the fourth sort of lesson before he even starts mentioning variables. And when he does mention variables, he does this in a very negative fashion. He says that I'm going to talk about this thing called variables. You should not use it. It is there because there are faults in the way we have designed our language. And so it exists. But you should not be using it if you can help it. And that blew my mind, right? Because that is not how we think about software at all. When we want to create a variable, we create a variable and we're done with it. You know, we don't give it so much thought. And so he highlighted this. He highlighted that variables are a slice of time. And let me explain this to you for a second. So what this means is that when you create a variable, you think it's very innocent. You just created a variable and you're done with it. But what you've done is you stored some state into that variable at that point of time. And now suddenly time is important. Until now, you were only dealing with data and processing data or whatever. Now suddenly time becomes important, which is crazy. Now, not only do you have to know what the value of that variable was, but you also have to know when that variable was set so that you can use it correctly. If not, if you don't have a sense of when it was set, then your code can be wrong. And I never thought of it that way. That was very mystifying to me. So here's an example. By the way, I'm using code that is JavaScript, but it's a C-like language, and so you will be familiar with it regardless of which background you come from. There are JavaScript specifics, of course, but we'll try to overlook them. It's not important. The syntax in the language itself is not that important. So here I've created what resembles a class, right? I hope this is visible from right at the back. So here I've created what resembles a class, and you can imagine this right here to a private variable inside that class, and this to be like a public method. So I call next, and what that's doing is that's just incrementing a counter and returning the latest value. And so when I instantiate it and I call next, what do I get? Now, obviously, the answer is obvious. The answer is that I get sequential numbers starting from 1, right? So I get 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on. The problem is you are never really sure what value you get unless you know what the history of that function call has been. You know what I mean? So if I call it at a certain time to get a certain value, you have to know how many times in the past it has been called as well for it to make sense to you, right? And it is such a simple thing that we do by creating this private variable over there that has got some state in it. But we don't think about this consequence, about the complexity that it has added to our app. Now, we can debate whether the complexity is worth thinking about or not, but there certainly is a complexity. We have to acknowledge that there is a complexity, and you have to think about what happened in a certain period in time in the past. So this is what the functional world, by the way, the functional programmers call this side effects. And it's not very hard to, so if you look up what side effects means on Wikipedia, this is what they say. This is the slide with the most amount of text, so please bear with me. It says that in the presence of side effects, a program's behavior may depend on history. It says that understanding and debugging a function with side effects requires knowledge about the context and its possible histories, which is very interesting. We're talking about software, but we're talking about history of the program. We're talking about history of the context, which is a very, very interesting idea. If you stretch this idea further, you get what the functional programmers call pure functions. So they talk about the nirvana of how functions behave, and so that's what they mean here by pure functions. And they generally will give you an example like this. They talk about how beautiful this is, such a pure function. This throws me off. It throws off anyone. What the hell are you talking about? It's just adding two numbers. You know, what's the big deal about? But there is so much beauty in this that if I try to explain to you, you'll probably get it. And so here's what it does, is that it takes two parameters and it returns a value without setting any intermediate variables. It uses the parameters directly and it returns a result. The result, in the course of returning the result, it has not modified the values of the parameters, which is amazing. It has not modified anything outside of itself. So the universe, so to say, does not matter to it. It functions by itself. Also, it does not cause any effect on the universe, so to say, right? Because nothing that it does is affecting anything outside of it. And you know, that's terribly useful. It's a function that is pure in the sense that it only does its job. It does not depend on anything outside of itself. This gets us closer, and functional guys keep talking about this. This gets us closer to the idea of a pure mathematical function, in the sense that, you know, if you remember y is equal to f of x, you pass in any argument, any x to it, and it will return a value y to it, and it does not matter what time it was called at, or what state is inside it at that point of time, or, you know, what is the rest of the universe looking like. All of that does not matter. What matters is I have called this function and I have passed it these arguments. It has to return a result to me, and everything in the system is reliable because it does not depend on anything external, and that's beautiful. And so functional programmers, of course, fall in love with it, and they call this lambda the ultimate, or function the ultimate. So there is a sort of ultimate elegance to this, in the sense that when you write code, all of a sudden, when you call a function, or when you call a method, or whatever you call it, it is not going to cause any state change outside of itself. And hence, it becomes very reliable to call it. You can call it without having to set up state. You can call it without having to worry about whether it will cause some state change elsewhere. No such problems are encountered. It runs as a unit by itself. And this gives you the benefit that all of a sudden, you can break this piece off and do interesting things with it without affecting the rest of the system. And we'll come to that in a second about how that's done. But before that, I want to show you an example of how this idea can be used, right? So here's an example where I'm creating, so this would be like the state holding sort of style of doing it. So here's the stateful way of doing it, where what you do is you create a new user and you pass some arguments into its constructor, right? And then you call a certain method on that object. And what this does is obviously it uses the, when you call the method, it uses the private state that was established within the constructor, and it works on that to return some result, right? Whereas if you look over here, there is a get profile where I'm passing in the arguments, and so it can operate directly on those arguments rather than having to use some state that it had got from previous times, okay? Is that example sort of clear? If you have any questions, by the way, feel free to interrupt me. I have a lot of time. I have underprepared. Just to give you an idea, users here is not an object. You can think of this as some sort of a namespace or some sort of a collection, some sort of group under which you can put functions in. It is not a state container. It definitely does not store any state in itself. So you can call methods without having to worry about whether other things were called before or whatever. There is no such thing as an internal state, so you're free to use it any way you want. All right, so this is a great example of how to use internal state. Now, this is very tempting. The idea is very interesting to me. But there are reasons why I program in JavaScript. It's a multi paradigm language. It lets you switch between object orientation and functional and so on. As a result, it does none of these very well, right, to be honest. But it does a little bit of everything. And so I have the flexibility to switch between different styles when I want to. So if somebody tells me that do the functional way, don't do it the object oriented way, that's BS, because I have the choice of doing it the object oriented way when I want to, and I would rather exercise that choice. when I don't have the niceties of a functional language, I will have to suck it up because my language is not a pure functional language, so it's okay. So in the same sense, I encourage you to sort of think about as well in whatever favorite language you might be, that you see if you can emulate your problems in this kind of a fashion where you try not to use state internally. Even though the idea is from a functional world, does not mean you can't apply this to an object-oriented world. Let's say I'm very bad at object orientation. I must say this at the outset. But let's say you create a class that has only got one method in it and has got no private members, right? That would sort of behave similar to this. So you could call it without having to worry about what state changes are happening inside, right? And so that's a very powerful idea. So that's what I meant, is that I'm going to take a bunch of shortcuts. And that shortcuts has to do with the features and the restrictions of my language, and you could probably do the same with yourself. So to give you an example, I am actually going to use assignment in my code, for example. Because even though I talked about variable assignment being a bad thing, it is only a bad thing in the certain context. It's a bad thing in the context where you use the variable at a later point of time. If I don't use the variable at a later point of time, if I just, you know, like for example, let's say I'm totaling up something and I want to save that in some variable just because it's convenient, and then I want to use that total elsewhere, but I'm not going to share that total value with anyone else, right? So that it's sort of within its own scope. Does that make sense, roughly? No? I'll explain again. So let's say I have got a total variable, a variable that is going to accumulate some total amount. Functional programmers say that, no, you should not create a variable because that's a horrible thing to do. I'm going to create a variable, you know, to hell with that. And the reason I'm going to be okay with doing that is because in the course of doing that, I'm not actually going to share that variable with anyone else. The variable is going to be created just in my local scope and used immediately and not shared with anyone else, right? Because if you think about it, every time you call a function, you are going to get some value. And you can either decide to use that value or pass that on. So there is these intermediate phases where you have value and then another value and so on. I'm just holding on to one such value and doing something with it immediately. So it's not such a huge sin, right? But if I store this and then somehow let this be used elsewhere, that is what the functional guys have a problem with. And that's a huge sin, right? So we understand that basically if you mess with time, if you cause time to stop somehow, then weird things happen. It was very difficult to find an animated GIF that explains this. The guy in the corner with the newspaper, by the way. So this is terribly interesting. This is we changing our thought process from thinking in terms of state and changes to that state, which is how we have always been taught in object-oriented programming, to performing tasks on units of data that you get. I started realizing this is how I had started to think since I understood this concept well enough. Is that so? It's really a sort of modeling versus data flow. It's a term that I heard today. Modeling versus data flow problem, where the modeling solution to solve a problem is that you take the data in and you encapsulate that within some sort of a structure, and that structure should have behaviors like methods and so on that you can act upon that data. That data acts as a unit and it operates upon its own internal state and so on. That's one way to model a problem. And that certainly solves problems, as you know, that definitely works. The other way is that you get data and then you just pass it function after function in a mathematical sense, with none of these things each individually keeping state at all. So they just sort of pass data from one to the other, right? So it's a shift in the way you think about how you write software. It is not just, so it's funny that I start this talk with variables, but this is how far it can lead if you think about variables correctly, right? And so it's about mentally imagining how you write software differently, and that's far, far more sort of insightful. So here we have, by the way, talked about performing tasks so far, which is all the function stuff that we talked. So that's all the tasks, right? That's the tasks that you're performing on the data. We haven't talked about data itself, and I'll get to that right now. Data is big business. Big data is big business, right? but no, of course, here I'm talking about data in terms of data that comes to your functions in a very, very small local context. In the modeling approach of solving problems, what the way you you represent data is to put it inside an object and to build structures around it and then build more complex structures on top of it and so on. That's how you build complexity in the app. And by building that complexity, you are able to represent ideas better, sort of, you know, like there's a person and then there is an employee and then, you know, there is whatever. So there are all these hierarchies that you build of different elements of data that is being shared by each of these guys. And so this necessarily makes you have to build structures that are somewhat complex in the sense that they have got a dependency graph, there is a hierarchy, there is an inheritance chain, right? And so there is some of all of that happening. But it certainly isn't the only way to model data. In fact, not modeling data at all is a viable solution as well. What you can do is you take the data as it is, raw, don't bother putting it into any structure, or put it in the most basic structure you can possibly put it into, and then just call function after function to operate into that, operate on that, right? And so invariably, a talk about data will end up talking about type systems, because I get data, and this is the very sort of modeling approach, right? Is that I get data in, what is the best data structure I can make to match, what is the best object I can create? An object is a data structure, it is a type, right? So what is the best type I can create to model this data correctly? And then from that point on, how can I then operate on that data? And that's the way you would think if you are doing this in a classical sort of modeling style. But in the functional style, you actually don't think of data that way at all. You just think of data as being primitives. Like, that's a string, and that's a number, and that's a Boolean. That's not a customer. That's just a number, or that's just a string. Sorry for demeaning customers by saying that's just a number. So data is you leave data in its primitive forms, and it's far more elegant that way, because anybody can use the data without having to know what structure that data conforms to, which is sort of saying that you have to share your interfaces or whatever, right? You don't have to do that in the functional sense, because your data is in the most primitive form already. It's already in the form of strings or numbers or Booleans or slightly more complex structures like, say, lists or hashes. And that's about it. You don't go whole hog and create users, or you don't create customers or whatever, because that's a far more complex data structure than just a hash of different items within it, right? And so it comes to the idea about setting your data free. Don't put it within the constraints of the structures that you create. This was an idea that I picked up from these talks by this dude called Rich Hickey. If you haven't heard of him, I strongly recommend that you watch his lectures. He's the guy who created Clojure, the programming language. And I think BG was here last time. He's from the Clojure camp. But more than Clojure, I don't know. I have mixed feelings about Clojure. In all honesty, I haven't given it a solid look, so I'm not the right person to ask you an opinion about Clojure. But he is a sort of philosopher of computer science. He's just got brilliant ideas about how to do computing. And so I strongly urge you to look at his talk. It's a talk called Simple Made Easy, by the way. It's on InfoQ. If you get the chance, it's a must-see. Anyway, so on the topic of data, how do you know if your data is simple enough? How do you know if you represent your data in the simplest possible fashion? And it turns out there is no hard and fast rule. In fact, a lot of people even disagree about what are the simplest data structures. For me, my rule of the thumb is that if I can serialize it trivially, then it's probably simple enough. If serializing it is complicated because I might not represent some internal state or whatever in the process of serializing, then it's probably too complicated. But if I can just serialize trivially into primitives, into strings and numbers and Booleans, then it's probably as simple as it can get. And so that's my rule of the thumb. Now, all this talk is fine. We have talked about not using, you know, sort of private references, internal references. And, you know, this is what the functional world calls it. They call it state. We are not using internal state. And if we don't use internal state, then we run into this problem where you have... So all these functional guys talk about the beauty of how there is no side effects, right? But truth be told, a side effect free program, a completely side effect free program, is either a very boring program or is impossible to write. And the reason is this, is because when you show something on the screen, that's a side effect, right? When you print something to a console, when you print something to a printer, when you send out HTTP responses over your socket connection, all of these are side effects. Because that has caused some change somewhere, right? And as a result, pure functional programming forbids these things, which is ridiculous. Then what's the point of writing a program if you can't get an output from it, if you can't print an output from it, right? And they've got very interesting, they talk about how monads are beautiful and they let you solve this problem in very elegant ways. Yeah, we can print to console, so I'll just print to console. You know, I'm going to take the simplest way out, right? But I'm not going to be religious in functional to the extent that I don't even print to console. That's just stupid. But that said, I'm going to try to make my app as stateless as possible and externalize state whenever I can into other stores. And we know about tons of state stores already. Obviously databases, you guys must be familiar with Memcached. Are you guys familiar with Memcached? Memcached is okay, I'll come back to Memcached. File system is another such store. And so are cookies, if you're using cookies over the web, and you know, cookie jars or whatever. That's some way of storing some state that you can then retrieve later and so on. Memcached, I'll come back to Memcached a little later. Meanwhile, just to recap what I've talked about so far, and I think after this we'll break. I know I'm a little like 10-15 minutes early, but we could take a break after this, right? So just to recap, the point I'm making is that try to make functions pure, which is that it should not have any external dependencies, nor should it cause any changes to the rest of your application. So try to keep functions pure and try to make data simple. And by simple, I mean try to stick to as primitive of data types as possible so that you don't end up building very complex structures around the data. I promise I have to talk about Errorception still, and I will do that. But we'll do that right after the break. Okay, so I'll go on some. Okay. I'm sort of wrapping up with my talk though. I was getting over. Okay. I went far faster than I thought. Why don't I just open this up for questions while we just wait, if you have any questions about stuff that I've talked about so far. I could talk about Memcached. So Memcached is technology made by LiveJournal, was it? No, not LiveJournal. It was LiveJournal? Right. It's a very simple idea. It's a ridiculously simple idea. The idea is that, so there is this thing called a Memcached server. What it does is that it opens up a socket for clients to connect to. It just sits there. You feed it tons of RAM. So you run this on a machine that has got tons of RAM. That's the idea. And then you can write data to it using the socket connection, write data to it, which it will hold in RAM. And so you, and then you can ask for that data back and return it from RAM. And people use, and there is no stuff about writing to disk or any such thing. So it's not meant to be a persistent store at all. Instead, it's used like a caching layer. So what you do is you check if the entry is there in Memcached. If it's not there, go make a database query, get the data from the database, put it into Memcached. So next time when I have the same request, I can get it from Memcached. And then now return it to whoever asked for that data, right? And when a subsequent query comes in, it'll go through this flow again. It'll go check with Memcached if that data is there or not. And when Memcached has got the data now you don't need to make the database query because the data is there in Memcached and you can return that instantly. And so this speeds up things significantly because the access is from RAM this time rather than from disk or from indexes and all of that. It's just reading from RAM and, you know, returning from RAM. And so your application speed up significantly. So LiveJournal did this, I think, so LiveJournal is a blogging or was a blogging tool. So they sped up their database query significantly by using Memcached as a layer in between to route their calls before they go to the database. So that's what Memcached is. It's essentially a caching layer that sits in memory, basically. And so you run this, like you can have a Memcached cluster and so on, tons of different machines sharing state and so on. That's what Memcached is. Any other questions? I was hoping for questions about, you know, pure functions and any questions in that area. So the functional guys seem to make all of this sound very complicated and stuff like that. And it sort of is at a certain sort of academic level, it's very complicated. But in practicality, it isn't. It's just about making sure about these simple rules that I told you. You know, it's not far more complicated than that. There is, you know, when you start talking about functions as first class objects and all of that kind of stuff, that starts getting a little weird. But until then, this is the rule of the thumb, and this seems to work. Okay. Any more questions? Any more questions? I have a lot of time to kill. I'm racing ahead in my slides. So you will have to ask me questions. That's how I'm going to buffer this up. We could probably do that at the end. Although I'm still talking about how to write a function. So it's a little weird. I guess I'll go on then because we have nothing else to do right now. Okay. So with these ideas, let's talk about having some fun. Remember, the ideas are very simple, right? One is that a function causes no state change or does not depend on any state change. And the second is that data is in primitives. And by primitives, I mean that it is trivially serializable. That's my idea of primitives, at least. The first thing I want to talk to you is, interestingly, about caching, which is what we just talked about. So I gave you the example about how memcached works, right? So you check if it's there in memcached. And if it's there, awesome, just return from there. If it is not there, then go make the database query. Take that, populate memcached, and then return, right? This is how you would typically do this in a sort of imperative procedural style of doing stuff. But if you had to take a functional approach, then what you can think about is, rather than caching at the level of the database, so memcache, you can imagine, sits as a layer on top of the database, right? And it's sort of like a cache store on top of the database. Rather than caching at the level of the database, how about we cache at the level of the function? So what we can do is that we can cache the arguments that were passed in, and we can cache the response that we got out from the function, the return value of the function. And if the same arguments are passed in another time in the future, because the function is a pure function, the result has to be the same. Right? Are you with me so far? So if the arguments of the function are the same, then the return value of the function has to be the same. There is no doubt about it because it's a pure function. And so I only really need to call the function the first time. Subsequent calls can be from cache. They don't need to actually do any of the computation that the function does, which is a very, very interesting idea. Now you're taking functions as units of work, and then you're saying, all right, I can cache this function call, or I can cache that function call, rather than saying that, oh, I can cache this database call or that database call, right? Which is very interesting. So the functional guys, by the way, if you ever meet them and want to look like a geek, you can use the word memoization. That's the word they use to describe this. It's essentially just caching at the level of the function. That's what memoization means. I'll give you an example. Here's a case where there is some function that does something. It's an expensive task. Forget what it does. Forget how this memoize function is available. It's available somehow. I can memoize get profile. You might not be used to this if you're not used to the idea of passing functions around. So I've declared a function which I'm then passing elsewhere. So this is definitely a JavaScript functional language-like trait. But imagine that function is like an argument which I can pass into memoize. Now, I get a new function in return. I'm sure this is all alien. You get a new function in return which has got exactly the same signature as the original function. And so I can call the new function as though it is the original function. What happens is the first time, of course, the call goes through. So when the function is invoked, it sees, oh, user ID. You know, this is an argument that I'm not familiar with. So I'm going to now create a new cache item for user ID. Then it will call this function, let the processing happen, figure out what the return data is, pop that into the store as well. And all right, so against this user ID, this is the return value. I have formed that association already. And so the next time when the function is called, it does not need to go through that process again. And so it will just bypass the function completely. And it will just use the cached value instead. And so now you can imagine you've got some code that is fairly complex and does a lot of like computationally intensive or IO intensive stuff or whatever. And there's no way you can figure out how to speed it up. You can do it completely externally to the function. You don't even have to go into the function to make it faster, which is just amazing. The power of this is just brilliant. You can take small units of your code and you can say, all right, this one's a little slow. Let me speed it up. add some spice, literally, and it's faster. It's just amazing, right? So memoization works for in the case of synchronous functions. Node has got this weird thing about asynchronous functions. But before I get there, I want to talk a little bit about Redis, which is very similar to Memcached. Really, it's just a sort of more Swiss Army knife sort of version of Memcached. Sorry, go on. That's right. Yeah. So the question is that is it cached for a different how does the caching work? I guess is the question. So it depends on the user ID you pass in. So suppose user ID A is passed in. And it has already been, the user ID A's request had come in before, and that data is already cached somehow. If a request for user ID B comes, obviously that will have to go back to the database. It's not available in cache, so it will have to go to the database. But if a request for A or B now comes again, it will not have to hit the database at all or any such thing, right? Any other questions about this so far? Oh no, so the code is not getting cached. So the function is called as usual and is just internal to it. Yeah, you're absolutely right. I agree.
Caching, you would do at different layers, right? You would have to go
database caching
or some game caching. When you have the function layer,
means you can
do that all caching at one
layer. You have to become specific layer. Yeah, and right. And what I like about it is that you're just sprinkling it around, right? It's not like you are caching is not like this intensive strategy that you have that, you know, I can like, do I have to look here and then look there and, you know, all of that kind of stuff. All that stuff is just taken away. I'm just saying that I want this function to be faster and it just works, which is amazing. I mean, the power of that is just brilliant. This is not, don't give me credit. This is all functional guys who do this kind of stuff. Great, thanks for asking a question. Any other questions? It really helps me. All right. So I was going to talk about Redis, which is very similar to Memcached. Again, it's an in-memory store. That this one does persistence, but it's not significant. Don't think about that. But rather than just storing keys and values, which Memcached does, so Memcached is essentially a key-value store, in-memory key-value caching store. This one is also an in-memory caching store, but it does not just support key values. It does that, of course. But it also supports keys and numbers, which Memcached also does, really. It also supports keys and hashes and keys and lists. And so there are like this bunch of data structures that it supports, sets, sorted sets, and so on. There's several types of data structures that it supports. And these are very simple, basic, bare bones data structures that it supports. So in fact, it's got the reputation for being called the data structure server, because you can say that here, take this data, and this is a set. Just do your thing as a set, right? So you can say add new things to the set or remove things, get me the length of the set and so on. So it's a server that lets you maintain data structures. Of course, a key and a value is one such data structure, and so it can be used just like you use Memcache. In fact, I think this is protocol compatible with Memcache. So, you know, there you go. It's exactly the same as Memcache. And so I use Redis rather heavily in my infrastructure. Again, remember, this is not much more complicated than just storing something in memory, except rather than in process space, I'm storing it in a different application. I'm storing it in Redis, right? So rather than storing it in my own app, I store it in Redis. And that comes back to the idea about me not holding on to state. I'll rather externalize the state to someone else and let them store it, right? And so I created this thing called Redis Memoizer. It's up on GitHub if you want to check it out. It's meant for Node and stuff like that, of course. And so this creates the function memos, the function caches sit inside Redis rather than inside your own app, right? And this gives me the benefit, not just that my functions go faster, but if I call the same function from a different Linux process, right, it is going to check the same Redis for caches. And so now, if any one machine, any one process has computed a value, no other process needs to compute the value because the cache is shared among all of them, right? Did you understand how that works? So not only have I sped up one function in one process, I have literally sped up all functions in all processes by applying this rule to it, right? And so that just explodes the possibilities. All of a sudden, it's like my apps have nothing to do at all, right? They're just reading from Redis and returning from there. There's literally no work going on. And so that's one of the reasons why, at least, I have been able to scale to the extent I have been, is just because of aggressive caching, but very trivially done. It's not like it is very hardcore, you know, it's very trivially done caching, but aggressively at all the important points where things are pure and things are simple, right? Is this a good point to take a break or not yet? I'm going to finish my talk. Okay. I'm literally at the last thing, so this is the end of it. I could. All right, the very last point go ahead. So the question was that all this is fine, but where is the caching actually happening? Do you need to actually still check whether the data is in memory? Is it in some sort of store, or do you have to? So you don't, because I wish I had an internet connection. I could have shown you how this works internally. But what happens is that imagine some sort of a it's the wrong words to use, but imagine some sort of a private state, right? And every time you make a function call, you are appending new items into that state. So imagine like a key value store maybe, and you're just dumping that, you know, all right, for this argument, this is the result, and this argument, this is the result, and so on. And so you built this hash. And the next time a call comes in, internally itself, inside the returned function from memoize, which is, this is the function over here, inside this function, it can check whether the hash is already populated. And if the hash is popular, it just returns it. It does not need to worry about the specifics about which is the function that was called, because all it cares about is that for these arguments, this is the result, and that's all that it really needs to know. You know, does that answer the question, sort of? So the act of checking whether the item is in cache or not is done by this function over here, which is generated by calling memoize. So memoize generates a function, creates a function that it returns, which internally does this job of tracking whether it is in memory or not. And so you don't actually write the code yourself. This code is just as you would write any regular code without having to worry about caching. And then you just say that I want to memoize this function, which means that add all the extras around it of having to check whether it's in memory or not and respond accordingly, right? That's what it means. Go ahead. So the question is that what is the limit for the memory or for the caches? In an ideal world, you have infinite RAM and everything is awesome. You don't have to worry. There are no limits. If you don't have an ideal world, you get someone to buy you more RAM. That seems to work. I have done this sometimes and that has worked. If that also doesn't work, then you will need to have some sort of mechanism of flushing out your memory, because what will happen is that very soon you will run out of all RAM in your system, and that's not going to be a happy place to be in. So there are different mechanisms of flushing out stuff from RAM. One is that you could so all of these Redis and Memcache, all of them, or even you know the memoizer thing. Well, not all memoizers. So some of the memoizers allow you to explicitly go and delete the cache if you want to. I don't like that idea because it's sort of ugly. It breaks off the beauty of having to just say, you know, cache this and it's done. So I don't like that. But the other option is that you can have some sort of auto expire style TTL thing, where you can say that just keep this in cache for about 3 minutes, and after 3 minutes, chuck it and go to the call again, just you know, to check. Ideally, all of this should not be necessary if your function is pure, right? If your function is absolutely pure, there is no need to throw the cache away because the cache is obviously always going to be valid. Though, of course, I am a guy who takes shortcuts, so my functions are not always pure. For example, getting a user profile is okay to be valid for 3 minutes, but you know it's likely not okay if it's the same user profile. I can't return from cache for 2 days, for example. That's not going to be okay. But for 3 minutes, if I return from cache, that's sort of okay. So within a 3 minute window, it's pure, right? Sort of. And so I can use that funda. And so I can say that my cache can expire in 3 minutes. By the way, the Redis memoizer that I created does support TTL and does support deletion of keys. And so that, yeah, so that's how you deal with it. Or you could, of course, explicitly go and delete caches. So that definitely works. You're right, though. Yeah, if it's a pure function, it's never stale. It's always the correct data. So there is no such thing as staleness. Though, of course, if it is not an absolutely pure function, then you will probably have to consider that this data is probably okay for some time, probably not. Like a user profile, for example, is likely to be okay for 3 minutes. So you could take a shortcut and say that I consider this to be pure function within the 3 minute window. So that works. There was a question about here. So the question was that is there a way to delete the cache explicitly at certain times when maybe certain conditions are met? Like for example, when you have caused a mutation somewhere, now the values definitely change. Now, pure functional, if you talk about pure functional ideas, then this does not make sense because then now your arguments are new. And so you would pass in new arguments because there has been some state change. You've got new values. And so you're making the call with new values, and so you know the values never really change, right? So that's how a pure functional guy would argue. Practically, though, it's fair to take shortcuts. There's nothing wrong with that. If you think that at a certain point the cache is no longer valid and you want to explicitly delete it, then feel free. There's nothing wrong with that. You can totally do that.
But
there is no link between the fact that you're writing data and the fact that you're reading data. I mean, the two things are completely different, and there's no way they are really linked. So this implicitly does not support that. If you want something like that, you would probably have to build it externally. But like I said, this does not fit. The reason this is not built in is because this does not fit within the functional mantra, because things are either pure functional or they are not. And if they are pure functional, this should not matter at all. You know, so yeah. I mean, of course. Practically, that's not viable to work with, and so you would have to build small constructs around it, and that's fair. So you would have to do that yourself. That's how it would be. But I guess what I'm saying really, and don't tell any functional programmers, is that functional programming is not really practical. That's what I'm saying. But like, there are great ideas that I try to use them. That's what I'm saying, right? Just don't tell any functional programmers that I said. All right, shall we continue? Again, because it's obvious now that I have a lot of time in my hands, I'm going to do a quick recap. And that is that we have talked about functions being pure, and we've talked about data being primitive, right? And that's what we have talked about so far. And one way of having fun that we have discussed is with memoization. And I talked about the fact that I use Redis for that to share the memos across processes so that other apps have got access to the same memos, to the same cache, right? I'm going to talk about the second and the last one, last idea that I have in terms of pure functions. And this is probably something you're already familiar with, is the concept of queues. Now, I wanted to start using queues
But when I looked at the sort of landscape around, right, in terms of, I don't know, AMQP or whatever those four-letter words are, all four-letter words should be banned. Seriously, I can't think of a good four-letter word. perspective. So it was clear to me that when an error comes into Errorception, it will have to go through some sort of a pipeline. And so, you know, already the functional model that I had been talking about of data passing through functions sort of seems to fit the pipeline model. But there was a reason for me to introduce queues into the picture as well, and I'll talk about that in a second. But before that, I want to talk about this particular implementation of queues that I created of a queuing server, which is actually a very fancy word to use because it's not a server at all. All it does is it uses Redis as a data structure store and is essentially just libraries that lets you write to the queue and read from the queue, and that's about it. There's this thing called Qmin, which I think was in my opinion is a very interesting name, but my sense of humor isn't the best, so whatever, take what you can from it. I'll give you an example of Qmin. Is that what you can do is you can say that NQ, so the scenario is that, you know, some user has signed up and or going through the registration flow, and you want to send him an email saying welcome, you know, that typical email that everybody just deletes. You want to send him that email, right? And so what you do is that rather than doing that in your flow, you can branch off and you can say that I want to put this into a queue and let that be handled elsewhere by somebody else to do. And so rather than calling, you know, the equivalent of a send mail function over there, you can just say that enqueue that into a mail queue, right? The mailer queue in this case. Just enqueue that into a mailer queue and be done with it. You can now respond saying that, hey, thanks, you know, thanks for registering and all that stuff. Meanwhile, what happens is that data has gone and sat in Redis. And a different app, in this case, mailer.js, imagine it being a completely different app, running in a different process space, you know, it's completely different from the previous one. What it does is it takes that data from the queue, the mail data, and it operates on it. Now, to understand how this plays into the idea that I've been talking about so far, you have to imagine that what I would have normally done is called send mail right over here and passed mail data as arguments to it, right? And that would send the email. But instead, what I have done now is that I have taken one function and I'm saying that this one function now behaves like an app for me. And I'm going to take this function, isolate it from the rest of the process, run that in a different process space. And that should be completely okay if the function is pure and if the arguments are trivially serializable, right? So I can take the function from within one process and run that in a different process space, and that is absolutely fine. That should work, right? And so now what you can do is you can say that, all right, I've got a complex task to perform. What I'm going to do is I'm just going to queue that up for different apps to perform. Let those apps do that one thing. Remember, it's just a function call, really. In this case, send mail, right? It's just a function call. It's doing that function call, and then it's, you know, either its job is done or it's writing to some other queue, and so on it goes, right? And so you're building this sort of tendrils of processing that has to be done. But what's fascinating is that, the downside, of course, is that you have now got multiple processes to manage. But on the upside, what you get is a flexibility to deal with these things. And let me give you an example. So for whatever reason, let us say that my mail queue gets clogged up and there are just tons of emails now pending to be sent. What I can do is I can spawn another mailer process. And now there are two mailer processes running, both reading from the same queue, right? But the two mailer processes are independent of each other. They probably don't even know about the existence of each other, and they don't need to because the functions are pure. And so the moment my mail queue gets clogged up, I can just start spawning more mailer instances, and that will help unclog the mail queue, right? And so that's just beautiful. I have seen that there is a scaling bottleneck in the way I'm handling emails. It's very trivial to scale that horizontally by saying that I can throw more processes at it and parallelly process all of those things rather than doing it within my own app, right? And so it's very simple for me to identify bottlenecks, first of all, which is a huge deal in itself. Just identifying bottlenecks is a big problem. And then trivially scaling it by saying, all right, I just have two functions doing exactly the same thing, running parallelly. And that speeds up my processing significantly. And again, I can do this because it is because it's pure and it is trivially serializable. Now, it is not absolutely necessary for it to be pure and trivially serializable. Obviously, this is the queuing is not an idea that was born in the functional world. It's in general an idea that is used in scaling heavily. But it certainly helps when it's trivially serializable and when it is pure, because you can now play with it without having to worry about what else is happening in that process space. Do I need to worry about things, you know, state in that place and so on. Another case is that I have got the mailer app running. The registration flow is one such guy who sends emails. There are several other people who send emails as well. Like Twitter sends that annoying email every other day about, you know, who are the, like, look at what your friends are doing types. And again, one of those emails that you always delete. But those emails can also land up in a queue. So there are guys whose job it is to decide what the email content should be, and there are guys whose job it is to send the email. Sending the email, that code remains the same, of course. So it's like the idea of code reuse. You have a send mail function, and you call that whenever you've got the data ready. But except sending mail is happening in a different process. People are just publishing to the queue, and there is a guy who's flushing away from the queue. So you have sort of got decentralized. You've broken up your app into several pieces now, and these pieces are talking to each other independent of each other. And this is very interesting. Now, all of a sudden, there is no fundamental change in the way we are thinking about any of this, though. We're still thinking about pure functions and trivial data. But it lets us start building all these things that let us take our app, break it up into pieces, scale that vertically or scale that horizontally, run multiple instances. And all of this just works trivially without you having to worry too much about, you know, concurrency problems or what is the state of things, or like, am I going to affect that, and, you know, by mistake or whatever. And that's really beautiful. The power of that is really amazing. And to be honest, this is, like, I was just sitting down with a code review earlier with Shetty, and this is exactly what my code does, and I'll show you an example. This is how it works in Errorception, is that when an error comes in, it is encountered by the web server, and all the web server does, literally, is write it to a queue and say, thanks, guys, thanks for the error. Job is done. Like, literally, that's all that Errorception does at the outset. Meanwhile, it's sitting in some queue. Now, in the queue, I've got, you know, I have to filter the error to make sure that it sort of matches certain criteria. Only then am I going to write it to the database. It's like an if statement. Like, if something is true, then continue. But rather than writing it as an if statement, I have that as a function which is going to return a true or false. And that function decides whether the item has to be written to the next queue or not, right? So that's like a filter. It takes out from the first queue and then decides whether it has to be written to the next queue or not. And so it's a filtering operation, because some things might not be written, some things will be written according to certain rules. So it's literally an if statement that would otherwise have been in your code, is an if statement. But here I've broken that out into a separate application, and I run that application separately, because that's a massive performance bottleneck for me, because I've got tons of errors that I need to filter at the rate of 6,000 per second. I can't do it in one process. There's just not enough processing power for me to be able to do that. But it's trivial for me to use multiple cores of my box very easily, go multi-core. You know, wow, that sounds awesome. You go multi-core without having to worry about all of these problems. That's amazing. Now, obviously, after filtering, there is deduplicating, which is sort of relevant only to me. And then there is, I have to write the raw logs to disk. And then there will be third parties and stuff that I have to notify about errors. All of these things are happening by pumping data from queue to queue. And that's a really powerful idea, because, you know, so for example, here's another interesting aspect, is that every once in a while, because my code is awesome, every once in a while it will crash. And so, you know, that was a joke. My code is not awesome. It was the most horrible code you've seen. So it crashes. But imagine this. Now, let's say that there was some problem with the filtering code and that crashed. If it crashed, it's that one process that crashed. The rest of the app is working perfectly, because the rest of the code does not have any inputs, because the one in the middle has died. But at least the user does not know about this. The user still thinks that the app is working, because he sends a request in and I acknowledge the request and I say, thanks, man, and, you know, it returns. And so the user thinks the app is working. Meanwhile, one of my app is down. I can come back later, aramse, and service that app to, you know, fix it or whatever. And it will take off from where it had left off. And it just continues, right? So it's like nothing has been lost. It's like everything just continues as normal. And so this gives you the flexibility to start servicing your apps. When I mean servicing, I mean bringing it down for some work and bringing it back up, maybe for an update or whatever. And you can do this trivially without having to worry about the rest of your app. So the rest of your app looks up, it's even processing the data, but there are pieces that you can pull out and you can say, all right, I want to shut this down, do an upgrade, bring this back up. And you can do that trivially with your setup if you're using this kind of a setup, right? Is that clear? Did that make sense? All right. So it sits in the queue, right? Because the intermediate data is essentially, what is the intermediate data? It's an argument that you are passing to the next function. So that's what's being sent to the queue anyway. So you can think of it over here. So here the mail data, for example, is the argument that is going to be passed to send mail. So that sits in the queue. That's the arguments, and the queues are in the arguments are in the queue. You can pop them out later, whenever you want. Right? Right. Right. So, yeah. In my implementation, too bad the mail. If you don't get the mail, it's too bad. In more professional queuing systems, what you would get is some sort of retry logic. So you would say that if this item failed, then pop it back into the queue and try again. But maybe delay it by 5 minutes. Let's wait for the system to recover or whatever. Give it 5 minutes and retry after 5 minutes. Or even better, you could have what is the, there's a term for that, where basically it retries in a degrading time scale. So it'll exponential decay, right? So it'll try after 2 minutes, after like 20 seconds, and it didn't work. So let's decay, let's reduce the decay slightly, and you know, try it after 1 minute, and so on. So whatever, so that's the process. I don't care about that. One of the reasons I don't care about it is because I deal with errors, and there are just billions of them that I get. And so if I drop one or two here and there, nobody really notices. So it works for me. Don't tell anyone, please. but yeah, that's one of the reasons it works for me. But I guess it depends on how critical, like for example, if you're using something like this for user analytics, you know, if you drop one ping here and there, it's not the end of the world, it's okay. As long as your boss doesn't know, I guess life can move on, it's all cool. So that's you know, that's how it works for me. Is it? There are lots of things in Windows that don't work. Okay, and there is one more interesting sort of fallout of all of this. And we Node guys are notorious for bringing this up every time we talk about anything to do with Node. Is about the Unix philosophy, which is the idea that in Linux or in Unix tools, generally you find small apps that do small things like, you know, grep or, you know, cat or whatever. These little small apps that do small, small things. And you string them together by using some interface. In this case, the interface is pipes. And you're passing arguments from one to the other and so on. So it sort of comes close to that philosophy where there is one app doing one thing. There is no shared global state. There is no such thing at all. The only thing the next app sees is what it gets from the pipe from the previous one. And so it's, there is this elegance to it that has worked for Linux for sure, which is seeming to be translated over here by using that the same model over here. Right? So you can compose your apps by using functions that pass data from one to the other much in the same way as our pipeline does. Except over here, rather than using a pipeline and store and passing it directly, I'm using it through Redis, but whatever, it's the same thing in a sense. And so, philosophy thing is another interesting one. And finally, before I close, this is the last slide, Naresh. Before I close, this is what I have talked about so far, and literally this is what is this is how Errorception is built, is that try to be pure, keep your data simple. Cache, make caching very, very easy so you can cache aggressively without having to worry too much. And break up your app into pieces so you can scale each individual piece as you want, whenever you want, and allow for that message passing between apps to be very trivial so you can build your apps the way you want, right? That's all I've got. Thank you. There's one more style, but that's about it. That's all I have. Thanks. If you have any questions, you know, I'll give. When one of the processes dies, nobody finds out, which is a good thing. Especially if I'm at a bar or something, that's really important that nobody finds out. And the queue starts filling up. So what I can then do is come back it sends me an email, so that's a good thing. And so I can come back, look at my email, realize that an app is down, and then go back and start the app. It's like nothing happened. Nobody will realize that it was down because it'll take all the responses have gone out correctly. Whenever the request came in, the responses went out correctly. That's absolutely fine. And whatever was not processed is now remaining in queue. I can start processing that. So it's like I've not even lost data. The data is right there as well. So like an app is down, but I have not lost anything around it. That's just beautiful. So the HTTP server, so obviously I have had to keep that to its bare minimal so that there is no scope for things to go wrong. Because if that goes down, then I look bad, and you know, you can't afford to look bad in today's world. So the web server is written, it's written in raw node code that is directly using the socket so that I don't deal with the complexities of frameworks and all of that, just because who knows what code is running over there. So I'm talking raw socket, reading HTTP messages, passing them myself and storing them myself into the queue. And that's all it does. It does not have any frills in terms of cookie parsing or, you know, whatever else parsing. It does not do any of that. It's just taking the data, dumping that in the queue, and that's it. Very simple. It's about 100 lines or so. It's very simple code. So I do get an email notification, but actually what happens, so in all reality, I have got a process watcher. What I do is, oh, the process has died, respond the process. It's an automated piece of code. So, but it does notify me that things are going wrong. Ideally, I mean, in most cases, I can ignore the email because if it has reached the point now where if things crash, it's because I have done some wrong validation somewhere, and it's because of that that things are crashing. The happy path of my code is absolutely fine. So I, you know, in general, I ignore such cases these days, and the machine just keeps continuing to chug on. So it's absolutely fine. That's how it goes. Oh, so Naresh told me that I'm supposed to come here to talk about distributed computing, and I haven't even mentioned the word distributed. So I'll talk about that for a second. I'm not qualified to talk about distributed computing because I have got one machine. That is what my server is. You will never hear a guy talk about distributed computing when he's only got one machine to talk about. So for some reason, Naresh thought I was qualified. I have no idea. I'm not. But it's not very hard to imagine that I can go from here to a distributed setup very easily, because all my communication is happening over a socket with stores like Redis and MongoDB and so on. And they are all separate apps anyway. So I can just take it, and rather than running it on one machine now, I can run it on two separate machines, exactly the same code, no modifications whatsoever, and it's trivially distributed to multiple computers. The reason I have not done it is because I don't need to do it. It's not because I can't do it. The app already supports it. And the only thing I had to do was ensure that it is pure and it's trivially serializable, right? It's so simple. And with that, now suddenly I can spawn this across multiple machines, across the world, across the network, across, you know, whatever you want, and it just, it's very trivial to write such applications, very easy to do that. It's amazing. So I'm not an authority. I've never done distributed computing, but it looks to me like this might be helping with that. All signs point to it, at least. Right. And I wouldn't say that's wrong, obviously. Well, when a request comes in, you deal with the request and you respond, and that's typically how you would write your programs. I do that as well. When a request comes in, I do something with the data and I respond, except that I don't process all of it immediately. I just write it to a queue. And this is because I can. I mean, you know, there are tons of cases that you probably, if you sit down to think about it, you will come across them. There are tons of cases where you don't need to do the processing in your code at all. You can just take that and throw that off elsewhere and let somebody else do it. And you know, so if you can identify such things, I think queues are great candidates for such kind of things. And you just take them, throw them elsewhere, let somebody else process it. You don't care about it. Just continue with your execution. You know, and so such scenarios, at least in my case, all of my critical code paths, which is all of the error logging, happens to be in that scenario where I can just respond and not have to actually process it really. And so my entire flow is based on queues, and that is how I scale, basically. And does that help? Does that make sense? Cool. any more questions? Yeah. Thanks. That was the intention. Thanks. Go on. Right. In my case, it involved a lot of beers, essentially. it's basically sitting down with people and trying to look intelligent and trying to like engage into conversation with them, where they start to divulge their deepest secrets about how they do software. That has generally worked with me. But this is because I was influenced by the functional movement, this entire movement about functional programming. And again, like I told you, I wouldn't actually be pure functional ever because it's just ridiculous. But there are a lot of interesting ideas from there to grasp and to soak up and to see if you can apply that into our everyday programming that we do, which is not necessarily pure functional. But at least see if you can imbibe those ideas and use them within your codes. That has worked for me over here. Again, like I said, this is not the only way to solve it. If you ask me, are there other ways? I don't know if there are other ways. This has worked for me. It has worked for me beautifully. To the point that I might even say that I don't know why others are not thinking about this. But in all honesty, we all know that this is not the only way to solve it. There are several other ways as well. I'm just saying that this has worked for me, and you know, it's definitely worth consideration. That's what I'm saying. Any other questions? Questions about beer are also fine. Not that I'm some connoisseur, but whatever. Time out. Putting me in a spot, dude. I have found that it is. It at least seems to work very well. I used to talk about that a lot in my previous talks, and then I realized that I come across as an alcoholic, which is true, but I don't want to say it too much. because I always used to say that I got annoyed about the fact that my servers were crashing when I was sitting with friends and drinking beers. And so it's really bad to have to pull out the laptop and tether your phone and start SSHing into your server while your friends are having fun and the buzz of the booze is just setting in. That's not the best time to start debugging a server on production. So, you know. I had to find a stack that would make this easier, and this is the approach that worked for me, basically. Right. Right. So if... No, I don't think it is, because if there is a case where you need to respond to the user immediately, it doesn't make sense to break it off from your flow currently. I mean, you could, it's sort of weird, but you could break it off and then come back somehow. But that's weird. I don't know if there's too much value to that. But if there is something that you can do out of band, then it makes sense to do it out of band.
Let's say I logged in, I said
Oh yeah, totally. Right.
So I could technically break it apart.
Sure.
If I don't want to stop.
Yeah.
Right. But I mean, it again depends if you can make something that's more sensitive than
it's Right. And there are cases where it is, like for example on GitHub, when you make a commit and you push that commit to GitHub, there's a ton of stuff that GitHub does. They prepare a zip, they prepare a tarball, you know, they will republish your markdown files. There is like just so much stuff that they do, which happens to be out of band. You don't need to do that when the commit is happening. It's ridiculous. So you can break that up and you can run that. So that's what I was saying, is that if you sit down to think about it, you'll be able to identify a lot of things that you can do out of band. And this fits that scenario very well. If it is in band, then probably this doesn't fit in very well. Right. Correct. Yeah, when you tweet, Twitter just responds saying that, yeah, I've received the tweet. Thanks a lot. It might not actually be processed. That will happen somewhere else. That's how it works.
Then on my client, there will be something that will fetch my tweet.
Correct. So yeah, the immediate response is that it was successful. It does not show you the latest state. The latest state you query for some other time, and that shows up. That's, yeah. Yeah, I didn't want to talk specifically. I would definitely do. I would love to do that. It's JavaScript, man. I can talk about it all the time. But I didn't want to go there because I didn't want to make this centered around the language or around a particular database. It's far bigger than that in my head at least. That's about the idea of how to scale. But in particular, Node has got interesting challenges as well because it is asynchronous, which means that you can do multiple things in your process at the same time while you're waiting on other things like I/O and network I/O, disk I/O, whatever. You know, while you're waiting for all of that to finish, you can meanwhile pick up other tasks and start processing them. And so at any given time, you're actually running tons of stuff in parallel, to sort of vaguely use that term. You're running tons of stuff in parallel within the same process. It is not actually in parallel, it's really sequential. So this is all a little tricky to explain. But yeah, it's sort of concurrent, it's sort of parallel, it's sort of not. But there is this weird model in which Node works. So there are, in essence, what is happening is there are several things that it is working on at the same time. So when a request comes in, it's not like I have blocked the server while processing that request. There are other requests coming in as well, and they are being served from within the same process as well. And that's how Node works, and that's how it achieves its speed, is by not waiting on other guys. It's just doing thing after thing by itself as requests come in. You know, I think that has confused you more than it has, but that's how Node works. I don't think these are far more fundamental ideas than about Node. So I don't think that has had an influence. Though of course, like for example, Qmin, the queue library that I showed you, lets you pop out multiple items from the queue at the same time. So you could just be saying that, you know, hey, so the way it works is give me an item, and you get an item. Maybe you'll do some database query or whatever to find out more about how to do or what to do with that item. So you're sitting down waiting for the database to respond or for the disk to respond. Meanwhile, it'll be like, hey, give me one more item because I'm just waiting, I'm doing nothing, right? So I might as well do something else until I wait for the database to come back. So you can pop out multiple things, and there are multiple things in flight inside your app, all of which are not completed. They're waiting on something else. So you're just, you know, you go to wait for those things to complete and then continue where you had left off when you issued that. And so I have enabled that, but I don't think it's right to say that has influenced the design. That's probably not. But it's definitely, I've allowed for it within the code. So I can do multiple things within the same process. Yeah. Cool. I'm just standing here because we have time. I could just, you know, call this off with that. Sure. I don't know about content. I'm not the guy to. These are all very hardcore fundas, and I want to like keep away from them because it's just too complicated. I'll tell you what I know. It'll probably confuse you more than you already are. Continuations are a way for you to. So these kind of terms are just very dicey to explain because people have got just so many opinions about what is the correct thing and what is the right. You know, so it's just a religious debate. But a continuation is a way by which you can say that. You go do that thing, and when you are done with it, let me know. in some way. So so the way you do that is, I could have shown you an example, but the way you do that, actually I could show you an example. Well, it'll just get very, very complicated if I show you an example. But so continuations are used very heavily in Node, where, you know, so the way your code looks is that you say that, so the registration flow, for example, you start the registration process and then you're like, oh, I need to make a database query to register the user. And when the database query is complete, here is the callback, here's the function that you should call when that database query is complete, right? And so it looks like it is sort of within the same flow. It's one level nested because it's a function, but it looks like it's within the same flow. But your code has meanwhile gone out, done some IO and come back and so on. Right? And so your code continues where the function was, and that's what a continuation is. This allows you, for example, to break off IO from your process, and you can do a lot of funky stuff with that. I'm not going to go there. It's just too complicated. Are we good? Shall we wrap? Yeah. Thanks a lot. I hope this was useful to you. If you have any if you have any questions at all, I'm just going to hang around for some more time, so feel free to come up.